It is a great pleasure to introduce you to Alexander Stiliev. He is a good friend and colleague of mine for I think 16, no, how many years? We calculated 12 years or
something. Yeah, more or less.
We know each other. And he's a professor at the Institute for Metal Superplasticity Problems in Ufa, in Russia. And he has, well, he's an expert in wood nanostructure materials and superplastic deformation. He has published more than 150 papers and 5 books on this area. And he has carried out his research work also in other institutions all over the world, right? Also in Canada, in McGill University, in the University of California in Davis, in the Naval Postgraduate School in Monterrey, in the University in Barcelona, Universidad Autónoma, and also in the University of Southampton. So it is a great pleasure to have him here today to give us an overview, I believe, on this topic, you know, wood nanostructure materials, processed by severe plastic deformation, from the fundamentals to the applications.
So, thank you very much for Stella for nice introduction. Good afternoon, everybody. Buenas tardes, that's okay. Something like that. Habla español un poco, but I will speak English, which also I'm not very good. But anyway, Teresa told me that because of recording, I couldn't say any bad words about scientists in the world. But I was not going to say that. I was going to say good words about myself, because I'm in that age that you have to start to write memoirs, how it was going on, what you see in front of you, whatever. Apparently you like climbing up hills and you're seeing that you're on the peak or on the summit and you see every picture around you. But if you put eyes upper, there is bigger summit in front of you and you have to climb. But I guess I will leave it this pleasure for you because you're much younger. So I'd like to start with some topics which are very general, because since 1996, when I first time came to McGill University in Montreal and brought the HPT samples, if I recall correctly, of copper and aluminum, so I can just give a talk like 20 years in severe plastic deformation, like Terence Langdon giving like 25 years in ultra-fine-grained materials. So just shortly introducing about myself, which I'm not going to say bad words. I'd like to graduate from Ufa, Russia, and this is just very famous statue of local national hero Salavat Tibayev, who is actually was a bandit by modern words, but now it's his hero. So you can be bandit, but in 200 years you will be hero. So this is just another statue. It's not many like you have here in Madrid, and this is some lakes, big lakes in near the Ufa. And this is my alma mater, Bashkirian State University, from which I was graduated very long time ago, 1981. So this is our building of Institute of Superplasticity. It's only one institute in the world with such name. Supposedly it should make research in only in superplastic behavior, but unfortunately there is a little research nowadays doing in superplasticity. And this is just, I'm going very quickly just to show more important stuff. It's very quickly, it's Montreal, Canada, it's new building. Where I stayed last 1998. We published quite a nice paper in CSL Lattice in Monoclinic Zirconia, quite interesting, with Valery Gersman, who is now in Canada. Recently he visited us and just we met after many years. And he's just missing, because now he's engineer and he's missing research a lot. So, and some results, and this is just quite interesting because it's first time we did in my research high resolution TEM, and this is just, it's not seen clearly, this is just broken the boundary, and with some imagination, you can say that this is end of this boundary can be disclination, which was very popular, very famous at time, and there was no experimental evidence for the observation of disclination. So we claim it could be some disclination. So, oops. And this is University of California in Davis, California, of course. It was a farm in 1910, I guess, in University of California, and then transformed to the separate campus, and there is a huge department of chemistry and material science, which is now quite famous for this material science research, with Professor Mukherjee, and they here we first time made some work on the nanocrystalline materials I brought from the McGill University nano-nickel electrodeposit, and we published paper, very nice paper, on the superplastic behavior. And since that time, it's already 17 years, there is no clear explanation why it happens. There is controversial explanation by Professor Mukherjee and my father, which I couldn't agree. And there is this behavior was repeated by Chokshi, and still no clear mechanism for it, to explain this superplastic behavior. So this is just a picture from this electrolyposite nickel. You see, we got almost 900% at 420 degrees C. It was world record that time for pure metals. Remember, it's pure metals. For pure metals, because usually people say it's impossible to do grain growth to obtain superplastic behavior in pure metals. So this is Spain. This might be last Spain because I'm here third time. First time it was at Bella Terra near Barcelona, the University of Autonomous de Barcelona. And I lived in Cerdanyola, very nice small village. So we did some work, and especially with this experimental parameters inference green refinement published in ACTA 2003, which got more than 500 citations now. So this is a research paper, not a review, because review is getting the citation much easier. And some work done with Hungarian postdoc Adam on the in situ crystallization during HPT in metallic glasses, aluminum-based metallic glasses. And we did also cold compaction metallic ceramic ferromagnetic antiferromagnetic by high pressure. This is just quite interesting now because it was first time for cold consolidation with very high strength material. And this is just beautiful, beautiful paradise. It's Monterey in California. It's among the five places in the world where the weather condition, humidity, temperature, air pressure is the best for retirement guys. The best. If you get enough money and you get retired, you have to go there and live the rest of life. And Professor McNally learned that. And one of the places was in the former Soviet Union Republic, Kyrgyzstan, near the Issyk-Kul Lake. And he said, "Oh, Alex, can I go there just to live there after retirement?" I told him, "Terry, you're living in this place. Why you shouldn't change it? It's just well the area." So we published quite good papers there, very, very strong. And we actually did on the steel zone friction, steel welding material bronze, like we did miniature samples to measure the mechanical properties. Actually, it was measured by mapping microhardness, And it's, of course, it's consistent with microharness mapping, but it just trivial tensile properties. So this is CNIM, it's in Madrid, you know where it is. And actually, also during this day I published quite nice paper, including the with Teresa. So actually, I like this work because it's high pressure phases in zirconium alloys. It's actually still actual and continuing in people. And also we published with Adam Rivers and Tony Spafford on the hydrogen storage in ball milled HPT consolidated magnesium alloys. And you see that there is some difference between ball mill, which is broken line, and solid line, that you can put more hydrogen inside, and it's actually in form of not powder, in form of tablets, consolidated, very porous. And also in 2011-2014, I've been staying with Terry Langdon in Southampton University, which is, you see the red bricks. You know, there is three types of the university in UK. White stones, red bricks, and glasses university. And they divide it like white stones, it's Oxford, Cambridge, which built from the white stones, very old, and they consider themselves only as a real university in UK. This is new one, in red bricks, which was started at the beginning last century. And of course, beton and glass, it's just brand new, which is just like teenagers, and they're not considered as a real one. So there is a very huge competition. But in getting grants from industrial red bricks, they have their own association, called like similar, like Red Bricks University of UK. And they got more money than the fundamental White Stones University for industrial research. So now it's just quite good in the top of 10 universities in UK. A lot of foreigners, there is no space to teach foreigners because there's a huge line before gates. Because there is strong rules in UK. You have to give a postgrad student a place, you have to give a computer, and he has to learn and study during the 4 years. So in this we did quite nice work with Megumi Kawasaki, who was a PhD student of Terry Langdon. Now she is a prof in Korea, in Seoul. So we put just like three samples, aluminium 1050, ZK60 between there, and compress it and just make a 5 rotation, and we got some increasing in the age, and after 5 we got intermetallics at the end, actually at room temperature by placing 3 pure actually metals, we got intermetallics. I guess it's happen not very often, and usually it happens during accumulatable bonding at higher temperature, 450, something like that. And finally, I got again here. This is, I'm just formally with CTM and working with Professor Jose Maria Cabrera and UPC, doing some work on ceroplastic deformation. So, of course, I could present new results, which is quite exciting, about the wear resistance and electroconductivity in copper chromium zirconium alloy, where actually we published recently a paper that saying that BKIS model is describing quite effectively the strengthening in this material. Also, we have done some work, new one, not published, in ultrasonic treatment of nickel processed by ECAP and by HPT, quite intriguing results, because depending on the amplitude, you can get following, I mean, further the hardening of materials or softening. It's quite interesting, and also some work on other materials. But I guess some of you not very familiar with high pressure torsion, and I just go through the principles of high pressure torsion very quickly. And then the most interesting part will be that if you have enough patience for this. So this is just three types of HPT sets, like constrained, unconstrained. This one is flow, free flow to the both sides. Constrained A and constrained B, which called by Terry Langdon semi-constrained like this and constrained like that. It doesn't matter actually. And in this case, you will get very thin samples, like 0.1 millimeter, and not very suitable for the tensile properties. In this case, both cases, you will get more thicker, like 0.8 millimeters in thickness, but you can cut some miniature samples, micro samples, to test tensile properties. This is strain calculation. It's very rough based on the geometrical approach. Probably it's not very correct, but anyway, some people using this one, calculating equivalent strain by von Mises equation, which is actually was developed for the very small strain, not suitable for the large strain. And this is just like setup, which it was firstly designed in Ufa in a lab of Rustam Valiev, who is my colleague, and he was a supervisor of my PhD work. So, and this is some metal and some achievable properties. So it's quite famous, you can find it. So, and FCC materials, like, because of HPT and strain depending on the radius, in the center, actually, by geometrical consideration, there is a gap, a zero. But measuring the properties through the disk, you can discover that there is strain hardening in the center as well. So it was just unexplained stuff, but this is work done, published in 2003 in Acta Material. And before that, everything published on HPT, the paper was saying after 5 turns and under pressure 5 gigapascal, you can get homogeneous distribution of hardness across the disk. But we did very careful examination and found that still there is some profile of micro hardness even at a pressure of 5 gigapascal and after rotation 5 turns. So depending on the number of rotation and load. So still there is some gap. You see there is still gap. Not small one, it's in range of the error, but you can detect it. So this is a microstructure. I will not stay. And this is just also first time using EBSD to characterize nickel in the HPT nickel, showing that there is a microstructure at the at the center and at the edge. So you see quite similar microstructure and misorientation distribution function also similar, but if you look carefully, there is some slight difference between them. So when we check with aluminium 1050, we found that after n equal 1, the homogeneity will improve significantly after rotation of at 6. It will be just straight line in error. It's the same, and this guy, Estrin, Yuri Estrin, and Dima Lobov, his co-authors, make a calculation, and they show that with a model of straining you can just predict that the gap in the center will disappear with the number of turns. So at the same time, in commercially pure aluminium, we discovered this theory that sometimes is grain size near the edge is bigger than in the center. It's controversial stuff because strain in the edge much higher than in the center. And Terry was smart enough just to repeat this material, this experimental work for the high purity aluminium, and found that this is just actually a crystallization take place during room temperature high pressure torsion of the aluminium. So that depending on the purity of materials, you can get or strain hardening or just recovering or just even the crystallization. So this is some work done on Kappler, and this is quite interesting work done on the rapid quenching nickel. If you put the melt of nickel on the disk of copper, rotating with very high speed, so you get some stuff, the ribbons, which have a big grain size. If you consolidate these ribbons with HPT, you will get further refinement, which is smaller than that one. And some, but unfortunately, we plan to at least to repeat our results for electro deposit nickel. But it's still a mystery. We don't get any superplastic properties from these materials. Why? I don't know. If somebody knows, it would be great. So this is just kind of work done on copper. A lot of stuff. I hope should not bore you, but I promise you to talk about application, of course. And this is just, I would say just HPT is not industrial process, definitely. Even now I know that some industrial application for, I would say quasi-HPT, I did show Teresa today. But that one, that setup is not for industrial use, but it's excellent model process for refining almost any materials, if you can get the proper angles, and to consolidate of powder of metals and alloys. But still there is some practical application, kind of geomedical parts, titanium, zirconium, nitinol. Because if you know some stems or screws, whatever, it's so tiny that can be done from the HPT disk. The magnetic materials, which can be done in shape of tablets. Because in that case, maybe you don't need to consolidate powders to 100 density. It's the same for materials for hydrogen storage. Usually in hydrogen media, it's in powder shape, which is inside of the some cylinder supporting this powder. And there is one problem after cycling, the powder starts to compact and it decreases its properties. If you do cold consolidation, that it will be like again in shape of tablets with some porosity, but it will be stronger with mechanical point of view. High temperature superconductive materials as well. There is a lot of investigation of that. Structural application, miniature device platform. This is just what I learned. So that nickel is actually based metal for the chip. So on the nickel you put some silicon, then some transistor, whatever, 100 millions. And it's when you get smaller in this transistor or whatever, put more stuff here, it's heating stronger. So it's just heating, cooling, heating, cooling, it's just like thermocycling. So then it's a problem when you put the coarse grain nickel, it will be anisotropy in different direction. During this thermocycling, increase extent in different direction with different size, it can broken this on the top of that one. So you can use a ultra fine grain nickel or nanocrystalline nickel just to make it homogeneous, that it will just extend in different directions with the same value. And just for welding, yes, as I show you, just you put two different materials, do HPT, and they actually welded with creation of intermetallic properties. So you can find more in this very nice, I like it, very nice review, which was crafted with Ishat Sabirov, he's here, and is in a recent book which published in Wallis and Sons, also that quite sick book, I will show you. And this is my collaborators. So the staff, there is two collaborators here in this auditorium. And this is what I published, something in these books, and something stuff. You think it's the end, but it's not the end. This is just a start. This was about me. Now about the final speculation on HPT nickel. Because in METS, in the last nano-SPD, we had big discussion with John Jonas, who was supported by many people in the staff, how to calculate the equivalent strain in HPT. Of course, any calculation is incorrect because it's developed for the small, actually, strain comparing to HPT. But anyway, when we calculate equivalent strain, you have to think, if you calculate equivalent strain in von Mises stuff, that means you put so huge strain in the material, when you multiply with the stress applied, you will get so huge energy you induce to the material. When you calculate this value, it's incredible. Let's see. So this is physical data. This is just steel H13, usually used for the anneals. This is the instrumental steel, which is a density, a specific heat capacity, thermoconductivity. This is temperature diffusion, thermal diffusivity, all this mixing, crushing and stuff. This is just weight of these anneals. Imagine, it's almost 1 kilo. This two stuff, 1 kilo. This is anneals. This is nickel, which is very close to density in specific thermocapacity and so on and so forth. It's smaller stuff. But look at this disk. It's three orders of magnitude, four orders of magnitude left. And I don't think some of you just ever experienced to touch these anvils after HPT. They are not extremely hot, but they are warm, very warm. So that means there is some energy going to the heat. So this is just set up. This is what it's. This is thermocouple. It's 7 millimeters from the disk. This is schematic, of course. And this is just measuring the temperature during the HPT process. If you recorded, and this is time or number of revolutions, because it's one revolution per minute for different materials. You see, of course, aluminum, the smaller increase in temperature. This is copper, this is nickel, the highest. And this is for some HCP materials. Think softer, of course, there is no like aluminum. And these two guys are almost similar. This is published in the Proceedings of NanoSPD6 conference. Let's calculate the heat released in anvils during the process. It's very easy. This is per unit volume. This is just density, heat capacity, specific heat capacity, different than temperature. You see the different temperature for 6, like 25 degrees, for 10, it's 35 degrees. So just very simple calculation give you quite big amount, 90 megajoule per cubic meter. It's huge amount, but remember, cubic meter is huge stuff, but it's just 4 unit volume. Then we have some data on nickel, HPT nickel, taken from the PhD thesis of Yelena Kornikova, which he got in 2001 in Ufa. This is just measuring strain, and this is stress, and you see that it's close to 1000 megapascal, which is 1 gigapascal, which very close to value you can estimate from the microhardness test, which is Wicker's measurement gives you 3 gigapascal divided by 3, it's 1 gigapascal, more or less similar. Then if you measure vacancy concentration versus shear strain, you see you can get up to 10 minus 5, huge amount of the vacancy, and Professor Zechetbauer claiming that all of these vacancy actually responsible for this unusual properties of HPT materials. And also dislocation density, very high, it's like higher than, closer to the 8, 10 to the plus 15 square, reciprocal meter square. So we can use all this data to evaluate how much contribution of the energy could be from vacancies. It's quite easy. This is just everything just calculated. It gives our 2.3 megajoule cubic meter, divided by cubic meter. About the dislocation, we can calculate this like this. Sorry, this is just some shifting, but by this equation, which gives 16.5 millijoules per cubic meter. And from the green boundaries, it can be evaluated by specific surface energy of angle boundaries, which is about 1 joule per square meter. And we calculate the total surface area per cubic meter like this one. It gives by the highest value, it's just normal. This is just very suitable. And if we calculate everything, heating gives 90, and all the effects gives 76. All the case gives you 160 megatons per cubic meter. Okay, this is good or bad? I don't know. But if we take the stuff and calculate the plastic strain, putting by shear strains, and shear strain, and we take like two stuff like this, it gives like 2 megajoule per cubic meter for n equals 6. If we divide it by time, which is 60 seconds, we will get capacity 5 gigawatts, 55 gigawatts, which is comparable with the capacity of renewable energy in Spain in 2015. So it's impossible. That means this calculation using the von Mises strain is incorrect. Using Hempel's definition of current strain, I got the evaluation like 173 megajoules per cubic, which is quite close to this value. So it's possible. I am not sure, frankly speaking, I'm not sure in my estimation, but the number we get quite close. But the most intriguing stuff is that the heat release is half of the plastic strain energy. Usually, in any calculation, people guess that heat release 0.9 of plastic strain. And it cost me problem when I estimate minimum grain size can be attained during HPT because when I take 0.9 strain plastic energy goes to heating, it was not enough energy for me to refine the materials, and I was getting the recrystallization. So that means from this calculation, I can guess that half to half of plastic energy going to the heating and going to the for the refinement of the materials. So finally this is the end, and it was 40 minutes, okay. I have been so fast, so I could speak slower. Thank you.
I got a question. So when you do your high pressure torsion, what's your limitation on your sample size?
It's depending on anvils and depending on condition, because you need to need torsion, you need sticking condition. So you need high pressure to make enough sticking condition to not to have slipping. So that means smaller size, you will get better condition. Usually people use 10 millimeters in diameter and 1 millimeter in thickness. But you can get smaller one. It's very, 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 very old stuff, so-called diamond anvil cells, when they use 3 millimeter diameter diamond anvils and just micrometers of thickness and samples. But in that stuff, it's very small one, HPTB one, but it's small one, you can get 100 gigapascals in pressure. So that diamond anvil cells was used for the study materials under extreme compression.
Do you need a special setup for the smaller
one? For the smaller one?
Yeah.
No, it's commercially available. It's just like table, on the table stuff. But for the HPT, if you see that, quite a big one. What do we need? Oh, here. This is quite big.
But that's 10 millimeters.
Yeah, 10 millimeters.
So is, you said this couldn't be used for bulk processing. Can you stack up parts?
You mean you can stack up, but as you get thicker, you break the sticking condition. All of them will be sliding. They just grow now, problem for the compression as well. There is a ratio between thickness and the diameter, actually surface area, when you can get sticking condition and sliding.
But some people have done two on top of each other. Have you done two pieces on top of each other?
Yeah, this is what we did. Three pieces. Actually, you probably missed the point. But they all of them was. Equation, and it's quite easily for this geometry, because if you have
can consider as an infinite semi-infinite plane. But the problem is, the solution of this equation will much depend on the boundary condition between these angles. Many people say, like, when you have 6 gigapascal compression, the contact so tight that there is no any difference. But there is difference, because if you look at this stuff, it's a thermal diffusivity. You see, even everything almost the same because of this guy. This guy is also even higher. I mean, it's the same actually. So there is a drop in the temperature between the samples and angles. If it drop, like decreasing the heat transfer to the angles, that means samples will be heated up. And recovery or recovery, this recovery process will take place. How to do? How to control it? I don't know. Probably it's possible, but even some darkness on the surface will change drastically your boundary condition. You have to be make sure that everything identical to make a set of experimental work and measure the temperature that to say, okay, I know what is stuff. Actually, one of the ways just to put thermocouple inside of the material and broke it.
Yeah.
I told the, what is this guy, Iranian guy with Habita?
Adalati.
I told the Adalati. But he didn't follow me. I told him just take a 2 aluminum disc, clump it with a thermocouple, and then rotate it. He did a little bit different. He put on the top surface, and then on the disc, and then press it and rotate it. Of course, thermocouple was broken after like half of rotation or something. But he didn't see any changes in temperature comparing to the thermocouple. Definitely, I also made some experimental work. I put thermocouple here on the side of the angles, comparing to this thermocouple. It was like 2-3 degrees difference because of the cooling from the side. So far, I have no answer what's going on there.
Between the clamps, there is any lubricant or something, because I guess most of the heat comes from.
Yeah. So when I came first to the Langdon's lab, they have very strict procedure to do samples. They put some lubricants here to make sure that it will be sliding, just to make easy. But remembering from the Rima Lapavok talk, she told me, when I put lubricant for E-cup, even they put it all times, the lubricant smashed away during the first pass, just immediately. And you have it, even our surface, just free surface. And the same actually happened with this stuff. Remember, this is 6 gigapascals. You put lubricant here, when you compress it, lubricant just flow out on that one. Almost there is no lubricant. And then finally, at the last year of my stay, Terry told, okay, we shouldn't use the lubricant because it makes definitely dirty samples, and just you cannot control sometimes it going to inside to cover the surface of the sample disk, and then you have no idea what is the condition for that sliding for sticking. Probably because it's closed surface, there is nowhere to flow out. It may create some thin layer for sliding. Mm-hmm. But actually, we checked in this paper, if you look, I did some samples with lubricant and without lubricant and measured the temperature increase. Absolutely identical. Absolutely identical. Mm-hmm.
Any more questions? Not, it's...
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.